Good evening. A warm welcome on behalf of the PPA Colombo branch to all gathered here and to the participation via live streaming. We are gathered here today for the service of thanksgiving to commemorate the 155th years of Chundikuli Girls College. Chundikuli Girls College, a pioneering educational institution for girls, established in the year 1896 by Mrs. Mary Carter, has marched forward as per our motto throughout the years of conflict and challenges. They inspired the girls in Jaffna by providing them a modern education and empowering them. Past pupils of Chundikuli girls all over the world, from Canada, UK, Melbourne, Sydney, etc., are celebrating the 125th anniversary, having service of Thanksgiving as a tribute to their alma mater, and these events are now culminate with the Chundikuli Colombo PPA's Thanksgiving service. Today, we are greatly honored to have with us Right Reverend Dushantha Rodrigo, the Bishop of Colombo, to be with us in this service of Thanksgiving and bless the school and us. A warm welcome to you, Lord Bishop. Mrs. Tanja Pires, Chairperson of the CMS Governing Body, it's our pleasure to welcome you as you are an inspiration to all our old girls, and you continue to guide the PPA in all our ventures. Thank you, Madam. Mrs. Dushyanti Dushidharan, the principal of Chundikuli Girls College and patron of the PPA, we are extremely pleased that you took time off the busy school schedule and braved the COVID pandemic situation to participate in this service of Thanksgiving. A very warm welcome to you, Madam. Your commitment to the school is greatly appreciated by the past pupils and is beyond words. Members of the governing body, especially from our brother school, St. John's, the principal, Mr. Tushidharan, and the OBA representatives of St. John's, we warmly welcome your presence here with us today. Your participation at a very short notice is greatly appreciated. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome our vice patrons, Mrs. Daisy Devasagayam, Mrs. Esther Amarasakara, and Mrs. Navina Devanandan. Thank you for your presence here with us today, and we value the contribution each of you have made towards the growth of Chundikuli Girls College. I too would like to welcome the volunteers to the choir who have taken time off their work to assist us in this service of Thanksgiving. Finally, it's again my great pleasure to welcome our past pupils of Chundikuli and well-wishers, not only from Colombo, but even from abroad, for joining us in this Thanksgiving service today amidst the current COVID situation. Thank you very much.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we gather here with hearts full of gratitude for your love, providence, and care as we gather here to celebrate the 125 years of Chundikuli Girls College, our alma mater, who has nurtured and guided us. We thank you for your blessings upon her. We thank you for the founders and the staff who have served in our school to impart knowledge, wisdom, build character, and prepare us for the road ahead. We thank you for the many blessings that we have received from all those whom we have met in school, the many friendships formed, the opportunities that were provided, and the encouragement received. We thank you for the way you have been with our school during difficult times, through financial crisis, conflicts, and pandemics. We pray for our present principal, Mrs. Tushi Tusitaran, the staff, and the students, that you would continue to guard them and lead them. As old girls of Colombo, we raise our voices to express our gratitude for our school, who has instilled values of hope, resilience, and faith to face the future. True to her motto, help us to go forward, holding on to what she has imparted in us, looking forward to the future with hope. May this time of worship be a time to honor you and the many memories our alma mater, our nurturing mother, has given us. We ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Parisutta, 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 engal pidave, unnadar, unnadathil, vasam seyyum. Endrum vaazhu.
Good evening. We meet today, the past pupils of Chundikuli Girls College Colombo branch, together with the old girls and friends from all parts of the world, to thank God for the journey of 125 years of our alma mater. The timing of this celebration could not have been better, for during this season of Advent and Christmas, as we reflect on Jesus Christ, who came to this world taking the form of a human, to die for us in order to offer a life of victory, of freedom and joy. Isn't it appropriate that we together be gathered to reflect and thank God for those who obeyed God's calling and with faith became agents and witness of God's liberating love in Jaffna. On occasion like this, such a milestone in our life, it is natural for all of us to reflect the past and dwell on the journey, tracing our beginnings and our roots. That is my assignment today. The story of Chundikuli Girls College is intrinsically linked to those stories of Christian missionaries, very specially to the missionaries of Church Missionary Society. 200 years ago, they arrived in our island, Ceylon. Their journey was amazing. They were, if I may say, the promoters of enlightenment through education to the people of Ceylon, as known at that time. Jesus Christ said, "I came that they may have life and have it to the full." And so did the missionaries. They came across the seas and crossed cultures. They gave up their comfortable homes, sacrificed the warmth of their friends and family relationship, traveled by ships for months and months to reach our island. Why did they come? Yes, they came because they had tasted the love of Christ. They came in obedience to the call of Jesus to share his love with those who had not heard about him. Yes, they came so the women of Jaffna, through holistic education, could discover their potential for a full life that Jesus offers to those who trust in him. The cry for education of women in Jaffna rang loud and clear. Mr. Halford Ensman appealed to the CMS missionaries. God heard their cry. He stirred the hearts of carters. They offered whatever they had. And so in 1896, with the encouragement of her husband, Mr. Reverend Carter, who was, I believe, was the principal of St. John's College, with one veranda space in their bungalow, which was their home, and Mary herself as the only teacher for 9 students, Chundikuli Girls College was birthed. Anne Offengartner joined Mary Carter in the following year to enliven the students of Chundikuli further with music, French, and needlework for nearly 13 years. Jesus said, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house." The missionaries shone the light of Jesus Christ through education to lighten up the women of that age who needed to be broadened their horizon. Mary Carter appealed to CMS for help, most specifically for a principal. The timing of Miss Goodchild's appointment as a principal couldn't have been more perfect. That very same year, Mary Carter breathed her last, but not before settling the new principal. With Miss Goodchild as principal came the period of stabilization, consideration, and consolidation and formalization of education, so the history says. Year 1904, it was time for furlough of the hard-working Miss Goodchild. In came our longest-serving principal, Miss Sophia Page. For 27 years, she exhorted the students, saying, "Seek to be faithful day by day in doing your little duties. Do with your might whatever you have to do. Be loving and helpful to all around you, doing all in the name of Lord Jesus Christ." Miss Kelk made a great difference to the hearts of the young girls and teachers during her service to our alma mater. During that time, Miss Muriel Hutchins brought in the flavor of Oxford English to Chundikuli girls. She took on the native Tamil and offered all that she had to serve Chundikuli, the poor. She continued throughout the war to demonstrate God's love. Some of us remember her and her humble lifestyle at the home that she created at Karuna Nilayam at Klinochi. Miss Ward Willis followed Miss Page as principal, but unfortunately succumbed to a serious illness. The torch that was lit by Miss Mary Carter continued to shine through her daughter Marjorie from our sister school in Candy Hillwood College, who stepped in to fill in as the acting principal until Miss Northway from Ladies College took up the responsibility in 1932. Under her leadership, the school moved into the new premises at Chundikuli. Jesus gave his life for us. Mrs. Mary Carter, our founder, is quoted to have said, when facing the teething problems, quote, "I will spend my last cent to keep the school going." In fact, she spent beyond her last cent to give her last breath for the school. We find her grave at the St. John Cemetery at Chundikuli. Miss Page, even after retirement, continued her exhortation through her letters to Chundikuli Girls College. "Be true, dear girls, not only in every word you speak and in everything you do, but in every thought. Follow him who is the truth. So shall you walk in the light as he is in the light, and will realize that the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses all from all our sins." 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. The prayers and hard labor of our founding missionaries has continued through many others. Let me finish with this quote from the Bible. "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us." Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Let our alma mater, Chundikuli Girls College, continue to run forward and soar high like the eagle with perseverance to be the light of Jesus through the holistic education. Thank you.
Lord Bishop, dear past pupils of Chundikuli Girls College, and well-wishers. We just heard about the beginning of our school, and we have divided the history into decades. And I am really privileged as we are gathered here today to celebrate and thank God for the alma mater for the 25 years. I feel it is an honor and privilege to share with you my thoughts and gratitude to my school and thank God for his blessings. I had two decades of close association with our great institution. From 1949 to 1959, I was a student. Later, from 1982 to 1992, I served as vice principal cum teacher. My paternal grandmother, Ellen Jnanaratnam Gunasagaram, was one of the oldest old girls of the school. Later, my aunts, my cousins, myself, and my daughter were groomed by this school. When I stepped into the school in 1949, there were rows of kajan-roofed classrooms. Just outside the classroom, there was space to play among coconut trees. The school office, the staff room, and science lab were solid buildings, facing a netball and tennis court. Close to the front gate, a hostel, the Grace Memorial Hall, and a small principal's bungalow were there. Today, when we enter the school, we realize how God has blessed the school with the expansion of the premises and solid, tall buildings according to the need of the school, and we thank God for His blessings. When I gained admission to the school in 1949, a very old girl and first national principal, Miss E.M. Thiliambalam, was our head. She came from Alvai and joined the school in 1906. After completing her school education, she proceeded to India and then to USA. After obtaining a doctorate, she returned to her alma mater to take up duties as vice principal in 1935. And in 1941, she was appointed principal. She is the pride of Chundikuli Girls College because she not only personally advanced so much academically, she also toiled in various ways to build up Chundikuli Girls College and inspire the students to aspire high. Although I was only 8 years old in 1950, I vividly remember the farewell to Miss Thiliambalam and welcome to Miss Saramathai. In honor of this event, a lunch was organized. We lined up class by class and marched to the hostel dining room, sat on mats, and had a sumptuous lunch on banana leaves. Miss Mathai was principal during the major part of my school career. She joined as a teacher from Kerala in 1926. She went to England in 1950 and returned to take up the principalship in 1951. Our class had close connection with Miss Mathai, as she was our teacher of English in the GCE O-level class. Miss Mathai was a humble, understanding and caring good teacher cum principal. She was a kind disciplinarian too. Once a few of our students had to stand in the office for one full morning for bullying a newly admitted student. Thus she groomed the students in the right path, steered the school well, and retired in 1961, passing the baton to Mrs. G.S. Chenoweth. I remember all the teachers who taught me, during my 10 years at school, and I'm so grateful to all of them. Even then, as time doesn't permit me to mention all of them, I like to mention at least a few. As lower school teachers, Mrs. K.P. Muthiah and Mrs. Rasaya, touch my heart. I like to mention Mrs. Stephen and Mrs. Pavalam Kumar Sami out of the middle school teachers. As I chose to follow the art stream in the upper school, Mrs. Hensman, Mrs. Nellaya, Mr. Ayadre, Miss Walton and Mrs. Poneya became my favorite teachers for the subjects I selected. The science section had great teachers like Miss Deva, Mrs. Paramanandan, and many others. By the dedication of all the teachers, we were able to advance academically and find our path to proceed in life. The extracurricular activities provided by our school for the students helped us to gain a well-rounded education with leadership, character, teamwork, friendship, and personal growth. My batchmates were lucky to have had Ms. Kelk as a teacher of English in grade 9 and 10. Not only was she an excellent teacher, she was also a musician and drama producer. I was fortunate in participating in two of her productions, namely Jane Austen's Elizabeth Bennet in 1956 and the opera Polly the Fisher-Maid in 1958. We also loved the English singing classes Miss Kelk conducted. Miss Kelk formed a combined choir with the boys of St. John's College in 1937. The percussion band for the lower school was also her creation. Carnatic music flourished under Mrs. Anandanayagam. Tamil dramas were staged. Our girls excelled in sports under the guidance of our PT teacher, Mrs. Champion. In 1958, our netball team emerged as champions in the North. Our classmate Rukmani Vedanayagam broke records in high jump 3 times in the AA meet. Mrs. Champion was a multi-talented teacher. I remember studying needlework under her in grade 7. For school dramas, Mrs. Champion was in charge of costumes. The Brownies and guiding movement flourished under the guidance of Mrs. Jnanasodhi Thambaya. The YWCA, SCM and literary associations were active at Chundikuli Girls College. The students enjoyed being members and benefited greatly. The different competitions held during our time helped us in various ways. English and Tamil elocution contests and the singing contests helped us to overcome stage fright and helps us later on in life too. Thus, the well-balanced education provided at our school over the years produced great women. We thank God for all these opportunities we had. The present principal, Mrs. Dushi Karan and the staff are maintaining the high standard of the school in spite of the difficult circumstances. May God bless them and help them to continue their dedicated work. Dr. Ms. Thiliambalam believed that education could empower women. I like to conclude my memories with her words. I quote, "Be worthy of Chundikuli's past. Be worthy of the opportunities of the future. The college of our dreams is based on faith, hope, and love. Let us do our part to make these dreams come true." End quote. Thank you.
A million feelings, 1,000 thoughts, 100 memories. And school day memories are timeless treasures of the heart. It was 13th July 1983, and I was in Colombo. It seemed an ordinary school day, right in the middle of the week. I was in a Catholic school in Colombo, and I went to school as usual. But suddenly, things turned out to be most unusual. Thick black smoke rising to the skies, didn't realize that it was shops and houses burning. We could feel the panic and tension among the teachers. Being a Catholic school, order and discipline were still maintained. Parents began to come and take their kids home. Good evening and warm greetings once again to everyone joining us in this service of thanksgiving and gratitude. Some days we wish we could go back in life, not to change anything, but just to feel something twice. Sometimes we can't let go of memories because they are constant reminders of a great story that we never expect to end. 1983 brought me first-hand experience with the internal conflict and civil unrest in our country. It is under these anxious and troubled circumstances that I stepped into Chundikuli, my mother's alma mater. Mrs. J. Veerasingham was principal. After an interview with my parents, I was escorted by my father to the lower school, and Rubini Miss took me into her class. On the way to the lower school, to the community during times of displacement in 1987 and shortly in 1996. The hostel had to be closed for a period due to the uncertain situation and high risk of housing the students in the school premises. Despite the exceptional circumstances, we managed to have the usual English Day, Tamil Day, competitions and celebrations under the guidance of our eminent teachers. Sports meets and even inter-school competitions were held up to district level at times. Prize-giving days were always special, with the guard of honor by the girl guides and little friends. We had an exhibition of Tamil authors during O-level days. Traditions and standards were upheld at each of these events in spite of the chaos and turmoil all around. This helped with bringing some amount of stability and a sense of security to us as students. Our principal and teachers instilled values of responsibility, perseverance, courage, and excellence in us in the face of adversity and challenges. The training we received as students and prefects during turbulent times prepared us for the many storms and battles of life. We are thankful for such supportive teachers. We couldn't have asked for more. They gave it with such zest. It is people like them who made our school world function. In 1996, the centennial year of the school, Mrs. Rajaratnam was appointed as principal, and one of the main highlights of her tenure was the reintroduction of English as a medium of instruction. This was the year we lost some of our students under very tragic circumstances, and the school made appeals to the Red Cross and Amnesty International. The school recommenced in April 1996, after about 6 months, during which almost 100% of the population from Jaffna moved out, some further north and others towards south. Due to displacements, the centenary Thanksgiving service was held in this church. A commemorative 2 rupee postage stamp was released in March in Colombo. Though we couldn't hold any centenary celebrations in Jaffna on the right date, we were able to have celebrations later on in the year. The current principal, Mrs. Dushantha took over in 2006 and has been able to build the school's profile in the arena of sports and other literary fronts. Infrastructure projects have been undertaken to expand the school and improve facilities available to students. The primary block, equipment to the science lab, conversion of some classrooms to smart classrooms are some of the infrastructure initiatives. Among achievements in the sports arena, Selva Gauri Anandarachakan in athletics and Ashika Vijayabhaskar in weightlifting stand out. There are many more achievements for which we don't have time during this service. In spite of all the hardships and turmoil in the country, the school has relentlessly marched forward. Thanks to the leaders of our alma mater, flanked by able sidespersons and supporters, the Lord has provided throughout the years. To quote from Proverbs 24:16, though the righteous fall 7 times, they rise again. I'm sure we all agree that fall is inevitable, but we will be able to rise again and move forward when we are righteous with the Lord. Through this, we will be able to bring glory, Lord, and honor to the Lord's holy name. We may have complained about our schoolwork. Perhaps we thought our lessons very hard. But with the passing of the years, the dearest memories we retain will be the hours that we have spent within our old school walls. The memories that we treasure will be the long gone old school days. Thank you.
The Bible reading is from John chapter 4, verses 3 to 15. He left Judea and departed again for Galilee, and he had to pass through Samaria. So he came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the 6th hour. A woman from the Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock. Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water. This is the word of the Lord.
One. The second lesson is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 to 30. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 to 30. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith, so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, it believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends, but as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror, dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know full, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love. Thanks be to God.
Honorable Bishop, our principals, our old girls of Chundikuli, friends, it's time to praise and thank God for our 125 years. Attain great things for God, achieve great things for God, was the great goal of Chundikuli Girls College as they marched forward. Everyone who walked through the gates of Chundikuli Girls College would happily praise and thank God for all the works well done. Someone is sitting in the shade today because someone planted a tree a long time ago by Warren Buffett. Our past principals, teachers, leaders, students, workers built it for a better tomorrow for all of us. Let's rejoice. Rearing human qualities in human being is education by William Wordsworth. And Chundikuli was thus the place for all of us. Each child has some potential. Help me to put it out is the child's cry. It's our childhood days that molds us to what we are today. And we have our school who took special attention to mold and shape each one of us, to move forward and build our talents. Let's give thanks to the Lord, as the psalmist says in Psalm 107:1, give thanks to the Lord because he is good, his love is eternal. It's time to praise and look back the 125 years that has gone by with God's hands upon Chundikuli Girls College. We praise and thank God for the decades past and still have memories of family and friends. My text for today is taken from John 4, 3 to 15 and 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 1 to 13. John 4, 3 to 15 and 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 1 to 13. Jesus was going from Judea to Galilee, and scripture tells us he had to go through Samaria. Jews disliked the half-caste Samaritans, so this looked like a strange route for Jesus to take. Jesus met the Samaritan woman beside Jacob's well. The woman came to the well during the heat of the day when she thought no one else would be there. Her encounter with Jesus affirms that all are accepted by him. The fact that she was a Samaritan woman did not matter to Jesus. The fact that she was not knowledgeable about the Jewish tradition did not matter to him. All that mattered to him was that she was there at the well. In his acceptance of her, the woman received dignity and self-worth, which gave her the courage to go into the town and reveal the truth about Jesus Christ to others. The woman who shut herself and came alone to the well when others were not there felt Jesus' presence and received eternal life. You and I are called by God to make a difference, to enjoy eternal life in Christ. Jesus encountered an unknown woman drawing water at noon. We learned that this woman regularly came at this time, so that she could avoid other women who would be drawing early in the morning. We see that Jesus intentionally sought to meet this specific woman at this time. Although she had a past history, God revealed it to her and still loved her. Through this story, we can learn some precious truth. The first most important truth is that many of us look outside of Christ for meaning. Jesus revealed to her that he alone is the living water that satisfies the deep need within us. Whosoever drinketh the water from the well will thirst again, but whosoever drinketh the water that I shall give, springing up into everlasting life. This implies that God gives an opportunity to this Samaritan woman. Women given the opportunity can influence for good. Sadly, many women are denied the opportunity to reach the full potential, which limits the influence they can offer to shape the next generation. Teach a woman to read, and you teach the whole family to read. According to my text, John 4:14 and John 6:35, 38, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. He that believeth on me shall never thirst. Jesus tells her, I will give you living water. He says, whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. The water that I shall give shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, Sir, give me the water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. The hour has come when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. They that worship God must worship him in spirit and in truth. Especially during this time, as the Samaritan woman ran into the town, told what she saw, are we as women ready to make a difference, especially during this pandemic time? Uplift another woman, feed a woman who is crying silently. Be the woman who fixes another woman's crown without telling the world it was crooked. Jesus always had pity on women, and women followed Jesus to the tomb Mary and Martha sat at his feet to listen to his word and also cooked for him. Jesus felt pity on the woman who had the issue of blood and healed her. Mary Magdalene anointed Jesus' feet with the expensive perfume. Isaiah 43:1, he knows you by name. Exodus 14:14, he will fight for you. Psalm 139:17, he thinks about you. Jesus always thinks about us. Psalm 62:6-8, he is our refuge. Matthew 28:20, he is always with us. Lord, I hope for your salvation, and I do follow your commandments. Genesis 49:18. We make a living by what we get, but we make a life by what we give. Victory comes by reaching out to those in need, by giving of yourself, praying for them, loving them, and serving them. Prayers are the stairways we have to climb each day. As said in Corinthians 13:4, love is patient and kind. It is not jealous or conceited or proud. Love is not ill-mannered or selfish or irritable. Love does not keep a record of wrongs. Love is not happy with evil, but is happy with the truth. Love never gives up, and his faith, hope, and patience never fail. So as women, we are called to be loving, patient. We should not be proud and not record of wrongs. As I end, I would like to say and thank for the determination of Mrs. Mary Carter, who said, I will spend my last cent to keep the school going. Miss Amy Goodchild, who systemized, regulated the education. Thank Mrs. Sophie Page, whose trusted God made her run the school, standing firmly on her knees, and all the other principals who followed. And I thank especially our present principal, Dushantha Sidharan, and I also thank her husband, who goes hand in hand to work along with her. As I end, I would like to share the prayer of Indrani Abhesekara, who passed away 3 weeks back, and that was on a centenary magazine. Oh Lord, I thank you for our principals, teachers, support staff, students, parents, and all others who have loved, lived, worked for the school. Lord, you are the giver of life. In the midst of suffering, we celebrate the promise of your peace. In the midst of oppression, we celebrate the promise of freedom. In the midst of doubt and despair, we celebrate the promise of joy. In the midst of sin and decay, we celebrate your promise of salvation and renewal. In the midst of death, we celebrate your promise of eternal life. Praise be to God.
Thy will, thy great grace. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we thank you for 125 years of Chundikuli Girls School. We thank you for all that we have heard this evening. For the women who served this institution faithfully, giving of their lives in the most difficult times to keep the cause of education alive in the peninsula. We thank you for their example. We thank you for imparting values that came from Jesus alone into the hearts and minds of children who were able to accept the good and leave the rest, so that they grew in the knowledge and love of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, for their partnership with St. John's College. And we thank you for the vision of the CMS, who began two schools, one for women and one for boys, in close proximity. And we thank you, Lord, for the generosity of principals who enabled their children from both schools to go at the same time to Casuarina Beach. And we thank you that through the years, the vision of the school has borne fruit in the present principal and vice principal of the girls' school and the boys' school, having found themselves in each other's arms because they studied in the two schools. And Lord, we thank you for their partnership for the schools and for their guidance and their wisdom that you alone have endowed them with. And as we face another year and another 125 years in your care and guidance, we pray that you'll take these schools from strength to strength. We thank you for the Board of Governors that directs the affairs of these schools. And we pray that your gracious favor will be upon each and every one. We thank you for the children whom you have entrusted to our care. We thank you for their homes and their families, their hopes and their aspirations. Because you, O Lord, grew as a child in favor with God and with human beings, we know, Lord, that you know the heart and the mind of a little child, because you have sanctified all ages with by living in this world among us. And as this season of Advent gives us hope beyond ourselves and beyond hope itself, give us, O Lord, the joy of preparing for the birth of Christ. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Good evening to all. I deem it a great honor and privilege to deliver the vote of thanks on behalf of the Colombo Past People's Association of Chundikuli Girls College, Jaffna, on this memorable occasion of celebrating and giving thanks on the 125th year of our alma mater. Let me start by giving glory to the Almighty God for making today's Thanksgiving service an unforgettable event. We thank the Lord for giving us the opportunity of getting together to glorify our school without any disruption in spite of the current pandemic situation. Our sincere thanks to our Lordship, the Bishops of Colombo, the Right Reverend Dushantha, Lakshman, Rodrigo, for consenting to preside at the service today. Our thanks are due to the Vicar of the Cathedral, the Venerable Perry Broheer, for all his guidance and help provided to us during the arrangement. The clergy and the members of the governing body for gracing this occasion with their kind presence. I would like to express our gratitude to Reverend Sil Roach of Holy Trinity Church, Vellavatha, and Reverend Andrew Devadasan of St. Paul's Church, Milagiriya, for allowing us to use the premises for choir practices. We extend our gratitude to our patrons for their firm support given to us during this period. A big thank you to our own Mrs. Tanja Piris, Chairman of the Governing Body for CMS Schools, for her leadership and guidance rendered to the PPA at all times. Our love and gratitude to our principal, Mrs. Dushanti Tusitaran, for her calm and collective manner in which she supports all our activities. We thank you, Madam, for your kind presence with us today. A very special thanks to Mr. Niranjan D. Silva for helping us with the choir music in spite of his busy schedule. Mr. Sureka D. Silva and his team for helping us in the live stream of our service today. The office staff and the sextant have also been very supportive and helpful. A word of thanks to Mr. V.S.P. Tusitaran, Principal of St. John's College, for accepting our invitation and for being present here. Our service would not have been complete without the loving singing by the choir, trained by our own past students, Kaushi and Neera. They put in a lot of effort and choosing the appropriate songs and organizing practices to make this service a great success. Our thanks to our fellow Johnians for consenting to join in the choir. They have always been supporting us in all our events. We also thank the children of some old girls who joined in the choir and attended practices regularly in spite of their own Christmas program. I would like to extend my sincere gratitude to the organizing committee who worked tirelessly to make this service a success, not forgetting those who contributed directly in many ways. If I have omitted anyone to whom we owe our gratitude, I say a big thank you. Please be assured of our appreciation. Finally, I wish to thank everyone present here and friends overseas who have joined us through the live telecast. A final thanks to one and all. We cordially invite you to join us the refreshment. Thank you.